Right, I'll still come in. So I'm very happy to introduce Maxim Lyutikov here. Maxim and I go back quite a while, we realized. In fact, I was at Caltech when Maxim was doing his PhD there, so this is in the mid-90s. And already then it was clear that he was a real theorist. But we had these joint meetings organized by Sri Kulkarni between the theorists and the observers, which are always a lot of fun. So he got to know a lot about the observations. So he is a good theorist in the sense that he tries to explain actual observations. And he's an extra good theorist because he tries to explain really difficult observations, or at least really difficult stuff. So he's the only person I know, at least, who understands magnetic fields a little bit. And that interaction with matter, and that worked a lot on very many topics which are all related to it. So at Caltech he was working on pulsars themselves, and you may think that that's similar, but actually he's not going to talk about the Crab pulsar as much as about the whole nebula and the interaction and the weird things that happen there. And in between he has worked a lot on more recently fast radio bursts, on magnetars, on other plasmas that I didn't follow as closely because they didn't interest me as much, but that doesn't mean he didn't do really nice work on it. Interstellar medium, you know quite a bit about the sun too. Anyway, so after, he's actually also a former citizen. He was here after his PhD in Caltech, and then stayed in Canada for quite a while, and quite likes the country. McGill, when Vicky was just starting her group there, and then also in Vancouver, and then he moved to a professorship at Purdue University, where he is now, but although really right now he's on sabbatical at McGill again, and of course really, really right now he's visiting us, so take it.
Very good, thank you, it was quite a reminder how old I am. Yes, so I will discuss two works in this presentation, and I think over the last few years, we were able to understand a very, very particular details of pulsar winds. And though I will be talking mostly about pulsar winds, but generally what I will be describing can be applied to many other sources of high energy emission. And what I will be mostly interested in, very, very fast acceleration of non-thermal particles. And I will explain what do I mean by very, very fast. So not just acceleration, but a very particular observationally demanding regime of very, very fast acceleration.
Very, very fast versus very fast.
Yeah, so it'll be very, very fast, not just very fast. Yeah. I will explain what I mean. And I foresee that this work can be applied besides pulsar wind nebula to other relativistic outflows like active galactic nuclei and gamma ray burst. In all these cases, we see lots of non-thermal particles and very fast variability. But the main topic will be the Crab Nebula, that all of you have seen it. So a few years ago, it was a kind of, in some sense, I see it as a bit of kind of a defining moment in high energy astrophysics, and that's the discovery of so-called Crab flares. And these are flares from the Crab Nebula. They occur a few times per year, randomly. The flux can increase by dozens of times. They appear in a very particular range between 100 MeV and 1 GeV. And here is an overall spectrum of the Crab Nebula. So here is 1 GeV, and you can see clearly two components. The first one is a synchrotron component that dies out at about 100 MeVs. And this is the inverse Compton component that picks up. Now, interestingly, the spectrum of these flares, and here I kind of qualitatively outlined it here, appears on this falling down part of the synchrotron spectrum. And the peak of the flares can be as high as 400 MeV, and that is very, very high. Not just high, but very, very high, and I'll explain in a second what I mean. And if you look at a broadband overall picture, so here is, this part is corresponds to this part. So, and the flare spectrum is almost monoenergetic. And that kind of explains why we don't see flares at low energies, because this monoenergetic spectrum is just buried under the overall X-ray and UV emission. Here? That's. Oh, yeah, this one, that's the optical. Yeah, that's emission from the filaments, right. And here is what I mean by very, very fast acceleration. There is a limit to synchrotron emission, which is independent of the details of the system. And that limit can be derived in the following way. In astrophysics, acceleration is done by electric field, but those electric fields are typically smaller than magnetic fields. And then you can equate rate of acceleration, and we'll scale electric field as some constant times magnetic field. You can equate the rate of acceleration with the rate of the synchrotron losses. Okay? And then you can calculate the synchrotron frequency corresponding to that. So this, from this you can calculate gamma, and then you can calculate the synchrotron frequency, and that gives us the maximal synchrotron frequency that we can expect in the rest frame of the emitting plasma. And it's about 200 MeV times this parameter eta, which is the scaling of the electric field with magnetic field. That already says, since we do see flares which peak at 400, that is already is very strange. Meaning those flares, they beat the highest possible acceleration rate. Okay? They beat it by a factor of 2. Well, factor of 2, you may say, well, maybe there is some mild relativistic motion, so that could be okay. But our dominant models of acceleration, particle acceleration in astrophysical sources, is the Fermi mechanism. And the Fermi mechanism is when you have a shock, you have turbulence, and particles bounce between upstream and downstream and gain energy in a kind of converging flows. But all these types of mechanisms give acceleration rates that are much, much smaller. Here I write that typically eta is 10 to the minus 2, but 10 to the minus 2 is the absolute limit that people were able to get on the best conditions. And eta is basically the parameter how many Larmor orbits a particle spans before gaining, before doubling the energy. And this mechanism of Fermi acceleration is way much slower than what is needed. So that brings us to a very important question. We need to find the mechanism of particle acceleration that will be very, very fast. Much faster than the conventional Fermi mechanism.
What's wrong with being relativistic? What's wrong with being relativistic? You're saying
this is all relativistic. This is. Yes. If you have In principle, you can account for this if you are, in this case, you are moving with a relativistic Lorentz factor of thousands. But we don't see that in case of crab. In crab, maybe one or two, maybe five is okay. But in case of a crab, we do not see that high bulk Lorentz factors. And we'll come back to those points many times over, so things may become clearer. Okay, let me skip that. So we have very demanding conditions on acceleration. So first, acceleration must be done by electric field of the order of the magnetic field. And by the order of means, at least 80%. 10% will not do. Okay? Basically, energy gain and loss on one gyro radius. Then, importantly, this energy gain must be on macroscopic scales, much larger than the skin depth. Skin depth is a typical microscopic scale, which is C divided by the plasma frequency. And in many laboratory and other applications, people do see acceleration, fast acceleration on skin depth scales. But here, we need fast acceleration on thousands of skins. Our acceleration size should be of the order of the size of the system. So it should be large, macroscopically large. Then we need a mechanism that would take few particles and accelerate them to the very high energies of Lorentz factors of the order of 10 to the 9 we need. And that's because these are such high energies, you cannot take all the particles in your region and accelerate them to such energies because the magnetic energy, just there is not enough magnetic energy. Okay? Plus, when you accelerate with such efficiency, you need to store magnetic energies before you start accelerating. And there is a kind of a conceptual problem. How you can accumulate a lot of energy and then dissipate it basically on a light travel time? Okay?
You're assuming that that flare is in fact cyclotron emission. How do you actually know that?
From the spectrum. And yes, from the spectrum. And actually, it really makes sense because in this radiation reaction limited regime, your acceleration rate equals one gyro radius, so it all makes sense, and then that's how you produce monoenergetic distribution. Because basically, if your energy is small, you accelerate well, but then you hit the wall from the radiation reaction, and you have a pile up. And the answer that I will discuss is explosive reconnection in relativistic plasmas. So, right. But the first part that I will discuss is so-called the inner knot of the Crab Nebula. Soon after discovery of flares, we suggested that flares can originate in what is called the inner knot. And what we have here is, so we have a pulsar. The pulsar is known to produce angular-dependent luminosity. Power goes as sine squared. So very little power goes along the axis, and a lot of power goes in the equator. And then you form what looks like a very elongated shock. So this is the shape of the shock. And this here is so-called Mach belt. And at this intermediate latitudes, the shock is very oblique. So the post-shock velocity will be kind of tangential to the shock surface, but also the post-shock Lorentz factor can be of the order of a few. Basically, it will be 1 over the angle of attack. And then if you can imagine that if you perturb this shock, then the post-shock outflow, which is mildly relativistic, it will be bouncing a little bit, and then this could produce flares. So this was the model that we investigated in 2012, but unfortunately, it does not work. So after our suggestion that the inner knot can be the origin of the crab flares, there was a very extensive multi-frequency campaign in Chandra and Hubble. And here is the zoom in on the very, very central part of the Crab Nebula. So I think that's Chandra. So that's Crab Pulsar. And then there is this blob, which is called the inner knot. And the overall structure is that these are the jets and these are wisps. So these wisps are located at about light month from the pulsar. And remember, we need crab flares occur on a timescale of 1 day. So the inner knot is a suspect. Inner knot is half arc second away. So there was a very detailed observational campaign. And here is one of the, what they saw in Chandra. So again, this is the pulsar. The red dot is the average position of the inner knot.
It must be HST.
It's HST. And we see that the inner knot, first, its position varies a little bit. So when it's further away, it's a little bit dimmer. When it's closer in, it's a bit brighter. Also, the shape is very characteristic. It is elongated in a direction perpendicular to the axis. And it's kind of what people call it, smiley shape. Okay? So, in the first part, we will reproduce the properties of this inner knot. And again, here, these scales are about half an arc second, so about a light day. So we're really probing the innermost details of the Crab Nebula. And the modeling will do the following. So we'll model the shape of the shock. And then we'll calculate the properties of the post-shock flow depending on one important parameter, and that would be the magnetization. First, we need to calculate the details of oblique MHD shocks. Oblique meaning, so here is the shock surface. The flow enters, like magnetic field is perpendicular. So there is a deflection of the flow. And then, so we need to calculate U2, the for velocity after the shock, depending on the angle of attack. And that will depend on the most important parameter is this magnetization of the wind. This is the ratio of the pointing flux carried by the wind to the particle flux. And that's the main parameter in pulsar wind nebula. And there is a famous problem. It's called the sigma problem. And the sigma problem says that we expect that pulsars produce high sigma flows, meaning highly dominated by magnetic field. Yet all the modeling of the emission of the Crab Nebula infer small sigmas. And there is a problem how to change. And here is the result of the modeling. So basically, we model post-shock flow depending on the sigma. And this picture provides a kind of nice visualization. So the red is the pulsar. This is the surface of the shock. And it is at these points that post-shock flow is directed towards an observer. And here is what we see. Here is the models for small magnetization, medium magnetization, and large magnetization. And we clearly see that only small magnetization can reproduce the observations. And it reproduces observations pretty well. We can reproduce the shape more, well, the shape is here is kind of frowning, but if you blur it with the resolution, it will look more like smiling. Smiling meaning if this is the nose and, you know. And we reproduce virtually all the details of the in the knot. And then, and one of the conclusions that the parts of the flow that create the inner knot have small magnetization. And we can expect that in the following model. If we have an oblique rotator, meaning when the magnetic axis is not aligned with the rotation axis, so then as the pulsar rotates, the equatorial current sheet becomes like a ballerina skirt. And then you can expect that these parts, so these are separated by one light cylinder, meaning by 10 to the 8 centimeters. And the toroidal magnetic field changes sign in each half a period. And then if you can dissipate this magnetic field, you can produce low magnetization. And then we think that the way if we plot sigma as a function of polar angle, then in the equatorial plane, we have in the striped wind zone, we have low magnetization. In the middle, magnetization can be high. And as we will discuss, we need it to be high. Okay? And here are the simulation, large-scale simulation. So now we are looking on the scales of the order of the WISP scales. And here we have low magnet. Color is the basically the magnetization, sigma. We have equatorial part, which is low magnetized. Then intermediate part, which is mildly magnetized, but this is more of a limitation of simulation. They cannot deal with very high sigmas. So here the sigma is few. But in the bulk, sigma can, for example, if you see here, so these are the flow lines, and the red means sigma of the order of a few. And then sigma becomes very high, tens and 40, actually, up to 40. Due to the kind of compression. So, and this is our the line of sight, and this is where we think the inner knot is located. Okay? And we also calculate polarization. And here, one of the subtleties is that there is this kinematic effect that if a source of polarized emission moves in that direction, and emits in that direction, the polarization rotates a little bit. So there is a kinematic effect of polarization rotation. And since at the edges, so here the flow is directed like this, but at the edges it is directed kind of in a fan beam. So that gives the rotation of polarization that decreases slightly the overall polarization. Anyway, our results, we can explain basically everything. We can explain the location, the size, the shape, the brightness variation, because you may imagine that if there are some perturbations, this inner knot can move closer to the pulsar, magnetic field will be higher, that will produce higher synchrotron emissivity, polarization, luminosity, and all of the properties of the inner knot. Important conclusion, since magnetization is small, this is not a site of gamma ray flares. Okay? In addition, if we zoom in spectrally on this inner node, its spectrum turns out to be thermal, not power law. That means you have a shock that just thermalizes particles and doesn't accelerate them, this particular shock. And we can even determine, from the temperature, we can determine the Lorentz factor of the wind. So here is what we conclude about how pulsar winds are made, are structured. So first, we have at intermediate latitudes, we have highly magnetized part. Then in the equatorial striped zone, we have low magnetization. Oh, definitely larger than one. Right, as I say, so here it's maroon, and maroon corresponds to few, but it's a numerical limitation. And because the codes become very stiff at high sigmas. So this could be very high. It's three in the simulations, but also you see the formation of the highly magnetized region starting from mildly magnetized conditions. And those highly magnetized regions are formed in the bulk, not at the shock. There will be one more line explaining this. B is also growing. So the red is the termination shock, and these parts, it's a kind of. So this is now a different work by Sironi, that he was investigating the structure of the shock at these parts and a kind of reconnection-mediated termination shock. While at the Mach disk, there is kind of no average magnetic field. So this part of the shock resembles more what we think everybody thinks is should be what is called perpendicular relativistic shocks, like sigma zero.
Do you ever start field lines or lofty lines,
flow lines, yes. Gray is the flow lines. We'll get to that. Yeah. In the wind, the magnetic fields are purely toroidal. But we'll get to the structure of the field in the bulk in a second, and in a few minutes. Okay? And then importantly, so here where we have the inner node, we have just thermalization, because effective, the average magnetic field is kind of large. And then there is this high sigma regions. And that's where we think flares come from. Okay? So how to make crab flares? So this is a very large work, 140 pages, we did for four of these collaborators. So first, let's look at the large-scale simulation of the Crab Nebula. So again, here are the scales of a fraction of a parsec. So this is most of the pulsar wind nebula. And here, what is plotted is magnetization. So, and you see that you do clearly see formation of highly magnetized regions. And this is more or less the same picture, that here you have highly magnetized region. And again, initially in the simulation, sigma is magnetization is small here, mild here, 3, and then it increases to 40. And the simple way to understand it is what is called Cranfield effect. And on the flow is more or less steady, though there is a lot of turbulence happening in the end. But for a steady flow, basically the curl of the electric field should be constant. And that means magnetic field times Lorentz factor times radius times velocity is constant. But here the radius changes by a factor of 2 or 3, but the Lorentz factor can change by a large value. So that leads to the formation, to amplification of the magnetic field. Okay? And then we looked in more details at the large scale simulations. So now here, this is kind of a slice of the magnetic field structure. So the lines are the magnetic fields. At an intermediate scales, say somewhere around here. Yeah. So there are these axes. But the point I would like to make is that we started with a large-scale toroidal field. But as the flow expands and slows down, it comes into a causal contact. And then we have a loop of magnetic field, purely toroidal. But purely toroidal field is unstable. It's unstable to what is called a kink instability. And what we see is the development of the kink instability, whereby this large loop of magnetic field breaks into smaller flux tubes. And actually, this turbulent picture is quite complicated. For example, here we see the radial current. So initially, the radial current was all outwards. Okay? Now, this is the equatorial zone where the magnetic field has been killed. But say here we see formation of counter-aligned currents. Okay? So this is development of kink instability. Basically, we see the aligned and counter-aligned currents. But we know that parallel currents attract. Okay? So can this attraction be the source of crab flares? And we started with a model problem, a two-dimensional structure of magnetic field flux tubes going in and out, in and out, in and out. Force-free configuration and force balance. Force-free means there is no pressure forces, only magnetic fields. And magnetic fields are very strange phenomena because if you have a field line, it wants to expand perpendicular to the field line, but it wants to contract along the field line. And then if you make some complicated structures of the magnetic, this pressure gradient that wants to expand can be balanced by the tension that wants to contract. But also this complicated dynamics leads to interesting instabilities and explosive phenomena, as we will discuss next. So is this configuration stable? So one interesting location is this X point, and you kind of understand why it's called an X point.
Are your lines here magnetic fields? The color is a current,
or is it? So the current is always along the field. So it's both, and color is Z component, and lines are in the plane component. So these are cylinders where one hand magnetic field goes like that, and in the other hand it goes like this. Okay.
Helicals.
Yeah. Okay. So one of the models that we adapted to this relativistic plasma is what is called a formation of the current sheet due to the Sieradzki, and the idea is the following: if we have this X point. It is, and let's squeeze it a little bit. Then what will happen is that the tension of this field line, so magnetic field lines want to contract. They want to be the shortest. But if you squeeze it a little bit, the tension of these field lines will overcome the tension of these field lines. Okay? And then you will see how it is torn apart. And this is the kind of analytical calculations. Sorry. It was supposed to be a good movie. Let's see. Okay. So we started with very, very small disbalance, and then suddenly, basically on a light travel time. So here time is a light travel time of the whole system. We have finite time singularity. And that feels good, meaning we start with a very smooth condition. There is no bad points in this picture. And then suddenly, on a light travel, and even if you think all the dynamics happens even on a tenth of a light travel time. But of course, it's all knows about, so it's all causally connected. So that feels good. But also, if you have very fast motion, remember, electric field is magnetic field times velocity. And if your velocity is of the order of unity, your electric field will be of the order of the magnetic field. And that's what we need. Okay? And indeed, you can show that electric field and electric field can be very high analytically. So we have explosive dynamics on alpha time scale, slow initial evolution, that's good, starting with smooth condition and finite time singularity. This all feels nice for the explanation of the flares. And then we did a number of simulations. So these are peak simulations, peak meaning particle and cell. So this is the closest that we can get to really simulating particles, meaning they trace every particle, they trace the electromagnetic fields created by every particle, and all the other particles, they move in a total fields created. And for example, so these are simulations of the exponent collapse. Did it run? I'm surprised. Oh no. Yeah. So the Lorentz factor. So this is the distribution of the particles, gamma d and the gamma. We started with basically 10 to the minus 1 plus 10 to the minus 4, and now on a light travel time, we are at 1,000. And so you see this large region of exponent collapse region, and it is macroscopic. You can also see formation of what is called the magnetic islands. And we did a very detailed investigation. So all the runs that we did, both with peak simulation and with fluid codes. So this is the distribution function. Yes, this is the distribution function. It stretches, and it basically those that started early here got a lot of energy. Those that came in late got less energy. But the particles that started early, their energy goes as T squared, because you bring in higher magnetic field with almost constant inflow velocity. And electric field is of the order of the magnetic field.
So if these structures were so unstable, how do you set them up in the first place? Is there some thresholding where you can bring in things slowly to an exponent arrangement, and then you reach a point where it's unstable?
Yeah. So this was the point of this type of... So here we processed old simulations. These are large-scale simulations. And unfortunately, in large-scale simulations, Oliver, who was doing it, couldn't trace really the merge of these two islands, because everything is flying relativistically. It's hard to pinpoint the location of these two flux tubes. So, and these two flux tubes have been created naturally from smooth axially symmetric boundary conditions. And I will touch on that question a few times later again in my discussion. So the acceleration. Sorry.
Display. It was playing, right? No? So, sorry, I guess I need to displays arrangement mirror display. Okay. Oh yes. Now it's.
So you see, we started with a slightly disbalanced X point, and then you see this formation of a large current sheet. You see the formation of magnetic islands. And this whole thing is moving in with almost speed of light. And as it moves with in with the speed of light, there is electric field, which is of the order of the magnetic field. And since we started with magnetic field zero in the center and some high field outside, you bring in higher and higher magnetic field with time. So very fast acceleration. Acceleration is due to what's called cold charge starvation. So this A parameter is the squeeziness. So we started with the squeeziness basically very close to unity, if you wish. But this A parameter becomes infinite, basically because magnetic field starts changing on a very small scale. So the changing magnetic field puts demands on the current. But the current is limited to 2 times density times charge times C. So there is maximum current that a given density can supply. But the magnetic field, because it becomes so, it changes so sharply, demands that the current be higher. And when the current cannot satisfy this demand, you start growing electric field. And it is this electric field, so-called charge-starved electric field, that accelerates particles virtually as a DC acceleration. And even better than DC, because DC assumes constant rate. But here, rate of acceleration increases with time because higher and higher magnetic fields are brought into a reconnection region. Okay? So, and we also see formation of macroscopic regions of the where electric field is of the order of the magnetic field. So here we are plotting 1 minus E squared over B squared. And when it's all yellow, nothing is happening. But dark means electric field close to the magnetic field. And you see a lot of interesting dynamics. And you see macroscopic. So here. Our simulation box, there are different scales, but basically thousands of skin depths. And we see these macroscopic regions where electric field of the order of the magnetic field. Okay? So that was purely the X point collapse. And then we looked at the large scale dynamics of these structures of magnetic flux tubes. And here there will be again a distribution function. And you see, we start, so this is gamma minus 1. So we start in basically non-relativistic. And if I play it fast, OK? So let me now play it a bit slower. So the system turns out to be unstable. This is the system is pretty famous actually in physics. It's called the ABC, Arnold Burgess Childress configuration. So for an time is on top in light travel times, and you see that for about four light travel times, nothing much happens. And what it means is the instability is growing. And it is still at linear stage, so not much happens. But say between 4.5 and maybe 6.5, we see very, very fast acceleration. See, now Lorentz factors reach thousands quickly. Okay, but the overall dynamics just overall topology just barely changed. And then there is a second stage, which I think most people who are trying to address this question were concentrating on the second stage, where acceleration rate decreases. You're still accelerating, but you see that these curves are very closely bunched together. That means the acceleration is not that fast. Okay, the energy of the particle doesn't grow fast enough. And we don't have radiative decay. You know, if you put radiative decay, this slow acceleration would not do. So there are two stages. One is the exponent collapse, where the acceleration rate is very fast, very few particles are accelerated. And then there is a second stage where you see most of the magnetic energy has been dissipated. And the key point, I think, the key point that we're making is this exponent collapse is driven by large-scale stresses. While most people would start with a kind of plane parallel configurations and would study tearing modes, so there are no large-scale magnetic stresses. Okay? So the particles, we can trace the highest energy particles, and they are, if you can see the... It is when it reached this, if I can play it again. So nothing, not much happens. And it is when it is in the exponent, it suddenly gets energy. So it is indeed DC acceleration, very fast acceleration during exponent collapse. So and energy goes as T squared. And we do see convergence to kind of slower, regular, Sweet Parker-like picture, and we see also formation. So this is called what is called plasmoid instability of a current sheet. This is not the same simulation kind of qualitative description. When you have a current sheet, it actually breaks into small islands. And then if the particle doesn't have much energy, it is trapped between these islands and acceleration is very slow. And that's the problem that people had before when they were trying to approach this. In our case, it is the initial exponent collapse so that the initial boost of the energy becomes so large that the particle doesn't feel, the highest energy particles do not feel this trapping in the islands. Okay? And also, this initial exponent collapse gives a kind of separate spectral component, we think. Okay. We also looked at the merger of zero-kind flux rope, and that kind of relates to... So here we have two current flux ropes that they barely touch together, and the magnetic field are zeros on the surface, so they don't feel each other. Then we push them together, you form a current sheet here, and this current...
The same, yes.
So we push them together, you form a current sheet. The current sheet, first you eat out this outer envelope, and when these two currents, they are parallel. So when they start talking to each other, at this point you have a dynamics which is very similar to our previous studies of exponent collapse of the ABC configuration, from which we conclude that it's a very general phenomenon, that is exponent collapse. So it's a special points in the plasma where that are collapsing and produce these effects. Okay? So overall picture, we have toroidal magnetic fields, that is, the flow is shocked at and slowed down at the termination shock. The system comes into causal contact. The toroidal magnetic field becomes skin unstable. That produces flux tubes that merge explosively. And it is the initial stage of this current tube merge, the X-point collapse. Particle accelerated by DC electric fields to a full potential. Here we have a full potential meaning 10 to the 5 light seconds. So it's and then there is a second stage, which is island merging, most of the magnetic field energy dissipated, acceleration rate is slower, but it still can produce overall bulk particles in the Crab Nebula. So the point that I'm making is that people have been talking about acceleration and reconnection forever in astrophysical surrounding. And here with the Crab Nebula, we have clear case that it is needed. It's a new, very fast, very efficient acceleration mechanism, which could be applicable to other sources. There are many details. So in case of a crab, we think that this happens somewhere in the intermediate latitudes. And by the way, this is the overall picture from the large-scale simulations that Porth and Komisarov did. And these are the field lines, and you see how tangled they are. So, and of course, our ABC configuration is a highly idealized, but fields are tangled, and you know, probably there you will find two parallel currents that will try to merge there. And also, there is a suggestion that we haven't explored that similar effects can occur in AGN jets, because there you also have a toroidal loops of toroidal field propagating out, and maybe in the blazar dissipation zone you have this magnetic reconnection effects, and probably gamma ray bursts. So, thank you very much. Yes. So this model is very specific to relativistic plasmas. And people have been thinking about similar effects in solar plasmas. But basically nothing interesting happens there. That's the overall conclusion. Yeah. So the initial model of catastrophic current sheet formation is from Sarovatsky, who thought about dynamics in solar flares. But the general agreement that the DC acceleration does not work in solar flares. That was the general agreement. Now, talking to solar physicists, they seem to warming up to these ideas again. But at least when I was studying this project, they thought that it doesn't work in, it's a different regime, and it doesn't work in conventional plasmas. Sigma is magnetization. Oh, 10 to the minus, so no, 10. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Question. So you get the time scale of a day out, but you also get the time scale between flares, that it's every few months. It seems very random. Or are they very highly directed that you actually have many more flares that you don't see?
Right. So so there are several points here. So if we look at the overall spectrum, these flares can appear also at low energies. Meaning if you have a smaller region, the potential drop over a smaller region will be smaller. And you can accelerate, you will be able to accelerate to smaller energies. But you won't see it under the overall bulk emission. It's only where you have a large enough region that you can accelerate to high enough potential that it will stick out.
I see. Okay, so you basically need to be lucky that things didn't already flare earlier in smaller regions, so you really could build up to something high.
Right. Plus, we do have what is called kinetic beaming. And kinetic beaming is a process where the plasma as a whole doesn't move relativistically. But the highest energy particles, they do move in a kind of, they are directed. So it's beaming, but not of the bulk motion, but of the highest energy particles. So yes, in order to see a flare, these beams should be directed at you. Then you will see the flare, while if they're misdirected, you will see them from the side, and that maybe a contribution provide the overall bulk emission.
I can still be able to see them if they're really misdirected, sort of hit something else.
Right. One of the projects that people were trying to do is, so if there are this, so you think of a drunk cowboy that is shooting in it. So, and this drunk cowboy can shoot not only big things, but also small things. And in principle, you could detect them in Chandra, as each pixel would have higher variability than from a short noise. People try to do this, but apparently it's very difficult. So, just technically difficult, and there are a lot of Chandra detector problems that you cannot get away with.
The value of B squared that you need?
Magnetic field here about milligauss.
1 milligauss.
Yes. So this happens at about light, about light day, a few light days away. Magnetic field is about milligauss, which is a bit higher than in the whole nebula in general. But here again, we are specified. So as I was showing, there are specific regions, we think, with magnetic fields that is higher than the average. So these fields will be higher than the average. Yeah. So, and the average is like 100 micrograms. So these fields are maybe 10 times higher than the average.
Okay, if there are no further questions, let's thank Max again and go for it.